ఇంట్రొడక్షన్ ఇన్వికేషన్ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం కస్తూరి తిలకం లలాటపటలే వక్షస్థలే కౌస్తుభం నాసాగ్రే వరమౌక్తికం కరతలే వేణు కరే కంకణం సర్వాంగే హరిచందనం సులలితం కంఠేచ ముక్తావళి గోపస్త్రీ పరివేష్టితౌ విజయతే గోపాల చూడామణి. ఇన్వికేషన్ ఈజ్ అన్ అటెంప్ట్ టు బ్రింగ్ అవుట్ ఇన్ టు ప్రామినెన్స్ వాట్ ఆల్రెడీ ఎగ్జిస్ట్. ద ఫ్యాకల్టీ ఆఫ్ స్పీచ్ ఈజ్ ఇన్హెరెంట్ ఇన్ అస్. అవర్ ఆర్డినరీ బ్రీదింగ్ ఈజ్ నాట్ ఇనఫ్ టు బ్రింగ్ అవుట్ దిస్ ఫ్యాకల్టీ ఫార్ ఎక్స్ప్రెషన్. So we take a long breath before we begin to speak. To pronounce Om pretty long, we must take a very deep breath. That is, we are invoking the power of sound in us. Similarly, invocation has been a regular custom for the Hindus. It is a vestige of the Vedic culture, a heritage from the rishis, and is a regular item in the Sanatana Dharma. We start all our auspicious undertakings with an invocation. For the Hindus, all undertakings are auspicious if they are capable of bestowing the largest amount of happiness for the greatest number of people for the longest period of time. The objects of invocation are three. 1. Sampradaya Rakshana. 2. Nirvigna Samapti. 3. Antakarana Suddhi. Sampradaya Rakshana is to maintain and follow the noble examples of tradition set up by our forefathers, gurus, religious teachers and other great people. It is an indication that we are not in the wrong track but following the right road. Nirvigna Samapti is the successful completion of the work undertaken. We pray that we may have enough strength to overcome all obstacles, physical, mental and phenomenal, and complete the work. Antakarana Suddhi is to get the mind calm. By an inspired invocation, the mind gets attracted to the subject on hand and gets detached from all other distractions. The effort becomes fruitful. Invocations are of three kinds. Vastu Nirdesha, Namaskara and Ashirvada. Vastu Nirdesha is locating the substance. A substance is that which always exists. It is Sat. It is never destroyed, which implies that it is never reborn or born. Such a substance is only one. The Upanishads describe it as the undescribable. It is called Nirguna Brahma. The Puranas describe him as the Saguna Brahma, the one in form. Vastu Nirdesha invocation attempts at describing him, the Vastu, with form or without form. Namaskara invocation attempts at saluting the Lord, Guru, sages and other great people. Namaskar is a symbol of the dropping of Ahankar, Namaha. Na mama, not mine. Ahankar tries to identify itself with the Atman. Ashirvada invocation expresses a prayer such as desiring that the glory of God may spread, that the glory of great men may expand, that the greatest good may befall to the community, etc. Here we have the Vastu Nirdesha invocation. It attempts at describing the Supreme. The Supreme is described here as the Saguna Brahman in the form of Lord Krishna. The words, by their implied meaning, also indicate the Nirguna Brahman. Sri Krishna, the blue boy of Vrindavan, is the one enchanting personality in the whole of the Gokula Vraja. He surpasses the other cowherd folk by his radiance. Because of his divine beauty, the gopis never leave his company. They surround him, forgetting all their domestic duties. They want Krishna and Krishna alone. He's neatly dressed, his hair is well combed and decorated with a peacock plume. On his broad forehead is painted the tilak with the sweet-smelling dark paste called kasturi, musk. The mark is bulbing at the bottom and tapering at the top. The celestial gem, Kaustubam, is hanging next to his bosom. At the tip of the nose, there is a rare pearl. He holds the famous flute in his palm. There are the jeweled wristlets on his hands. His whole body shines attractive, being smeared with the yellow sandal paste. There is a pearl garland round his neck. Really, he outshines all other cowherd men in the Gokul of Raja. He is ever glorious and victorious. This is Sagunopasana, and every devotee is enchanted by this description. Sri Krishna is said to be the Paramatman, the Lord of the universe. How can a little boy, admired by a group of rustic ladies, be considered as the Lord of the universe? The indications are evident here. The above is the concept of the Lord as seen by the fleshy eyes when the Lord is available as an avatar, an ocular vision. The eyes are the most highly sensitive organs of perception of man. This is the maximum beauty that can be appreciated by the eyes. But the Lord is buddhigrahyam atindriyam, the intellect being situated very proximate to the self, must recede well beyond the boundaries of the senses to taste the real nature of the self. The self or Brahman is Jnanam. He is also indicated as Sat Chit Anandam. Sat is the substratum over which everything stands. The beautiful tilak on the broad forehead of the Lord, which is mentioned as the first item here, is the indication of Jnanam. It represents the Jnana Chakshuhu. It is in the center of the forehead, as in the case of Lord Shiva. But Shiva's third eye is always closed and opens only to destroy. But this divine eye is ever open. It's open in the waking, dream, deep sleep, the Turiya states and beyond. It blesses all the states but never destroys. It is unfathomable, so is dark like the musk. Over his bosom hangs the gem, Kaustubam, which is but a solid form for Anand. His Anand is so perfect that it cannot bear to see any misery, unhappiness or sorrow. So it swells with compassion, grace, love, affection, kindness and generosity for creatures. It is his heart itself. It's a rare jewel which nobody else possesses. Kare Kankanam. The Lord is not a lady to wear bangles. It is the Kankanam, the yellow band of thread wound round the wrist when one undertakes an auspicious work. It denotes a resolve. The Lord has resolved. Gita chapter 4, Shloka 8. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. Gita chapter 9 shlokam 12. Ananyas chintayan tomam ye janaha paryupasate tesham nityabhi yuktanam yogakshemam vahamyaham. Gita chapter 9 shlokam 31. Kaunteya pratijanihi na me bhaktah pranashyati. Gita chapter 18 shlokam 66. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja aham tva sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma sucha. He is resolved to accomplish all these resolves. So the yellow band denotes his might, his chit or chaitanya shakti. This power manifests as Ichcha Shakti, Jnana Shakti and Kriya Shakti, the power to wish, plan and execute. Thus, three indications of Brahman are given and they are followed by three methods of approach. Nasagre Varamauktikam, Nasagre Varamauktikam. At the tip of the nose, there is a rare pearl, a pearl which is not visible to the naked eye. A pearl cannot be made to stand on tip of the nose. It's the tip of the nose itself, a rare pearl where the seeker is advised to converge his looks, as if seeing a pearl without looking at other directions. Gita chapter 6 slokam 13. Sampreksya nasikagram swam dishachana valokyayan. This is dhyana marga of approach. In the palm is the famous flute. This is the pure bhakti marga of complete surrender or sharanagati. The seeker must become completely empty of all ahankar, like a hollow bamboo stick, and place himself in the hands of the Lord. Then the Lord will play all his tunes through the seven holes of five sense organs, mind and intellect, and use him as a flute. Round his neck is a pearl garland, which denotes the japamala and shows the karma marga. The seeker can reach the Lord through japa, tapa, upasana, or other dedicated work. The Lord appears in a form only when he utilizes prakriti. Devoid of prakriti, he is formless. Prakriti is denoted as the yellow color of the sandal paste, which is smeared all over his body. This paste or prakriti is sulalitam. It is lovely, luring, and attractive. It is maya. He is the Maya Prabhu. He shines through the luring Maya. Gopastri Pariveshtitau. He is always surrounded by Gopastri. Gopa, Gopya, Gopana is to hide. Gopastri means through waves of sensuous tendencies. The pure self Atman is always hidden by thought waves which are of earthly nature. I want fame, I want victory, I want riches, I want children, I want promotion, I want happiness. Such thought waves are always hiding the ever effulgent self. If these thought waves could stop, take rest, but for a fraction of a second, the Lord shines forth. Atma Darshan is imminent. Gopala Chutamanihi. Gopalas are those who are able to command the cows, which are no other than the sense organs. Those who have controlled their sense organs and directed them to higher channels are the Gopalas. They are the great sages, saints, munis, rishis, and the maharishis. The Lord is the crown jewel among such sages because they are but trying to reach, attain, merge, and lose all their sense of duality and become one with Him. He is ever victorious. He shines forth among the sages. He shines among the living creatures. He shines among all the manifestations of life. Without Him, none of these will have the semblance of existence. That is Sri Krishna Paramatman, the Lord of the universe. We invoke His blessings. Every great work shines forth on account of the greatness and mutual cooperation of four factors, and they are called Anubandha Chatushtaya, the four interrelated factors. They are Adhikari, the agent, Vishaya, the matter, Sambandha, the relationship, and Prayojana, the usefulness. In respect of Srimad Bhagavata, Raja Parikshit was the Adhikari, who was fully qualified to receive the Brahma Vidya, or the knowledge of the Brahman, or Self, for he was capable of renouncing every earthly possession in a moment's decision. The Vishaya, or matter dealt with here, is the knowledge of the Self, through the Leelas of the Lord. The Sambandham or relationship is that the knowledge was imparted to Parikshit when he was in distress, that is, when he was in agony, fearing that death would overtake him in 7 days. Even the bravest man is afraid of death. Removal of this fear is possible only through Brahma Vidya or true knowledge. The Prayojana is that the knowledge imparted by Sukadeva was capable of removing the fear of Parikshit. Fear is a product of ignorance. Ignorance is removed only by knowledge. The fear, ignorance, distress, and pain suffered by Parikshit was removed by knowledge imparted by Sukadeva. Thereby, Parikshit understood that it was the body that was to die and that he was eternal. His pain having disappeared, joy or anand supervened. Pain, suffering or dukkha is foreign to the soul. Anand is its nature. Anand is not newly created. When the clouds are blown away, the sunshine manifests itself. It's not newly created. When the heavy load on the head is removed, the coolie, his pain having been removed, experiences joy. Nobody gives him the joy. It is inherent in him. Thus, Srimad Bhagavatam, having the four factors of Anubandha Chatushtaya of a superior order, is capable of bestowing the same supreme benefit on the readers as it was capable of bestowing on Parikshit. Bommera Potana, the great devotee and author of Srimad Andhra Mahabhagavatam, had said while commencing his monumental work, "What I am going to narrate is the Bhagavatam, the stories of the Lord. The motive power that is propelling me to do so is the all-powerful Sri Rama, the Atma Rama or Antaratman. The result of my effort is said to rid me of the chain of birth and death. And so, why should I waste my energy in writing other stories of mortals? This small book is being attempted in the shadow of the above sentiment. The matter will be presented in small stories or personality sketches, which will ultimately cover the whole Purana. The term story is used here for quick understanding, but really the matter to be presented is not a story or history, but is only his story. His stories are always clouded in mystery, but a little inquiry will show that there is no mystery here because it is all my story, a personal unveiling or self-inquiry. Thus, when heard as his story, it is really a nectar for the ears of the devotees. The thirst to hear such stories never ends. The longing never ends till the hearer, hearing, unheard, merge in one.